Fuck those damn dogs. Alright. What it do, YouTube? It's Real Wrestling Crew, back with Real Wrestling, episode 46. My name's Diakis. Everybody introduce yourselves.
The Real X Dog.
Oh, yeah.
Whitey.
The Concept.
Okay, what just happened? Well, Money in the Bank just happened, but let's go ahead and cover NXT TakeOver The End. Let's get some scores.
I did see it and summarize most of it.
I give it a 9.
And if I remember correctly, I think I said my in compared to other NXTs, I think I gave it an 8.5 or something like that. Overall, I'll give it a 9.
I'll give it a 7.8.
Oh. Hmm. We're talking about
NXT? No, we're talking about The End.
Okay. Sorry. I'd say it was a 9 because I had no
problem. Hold up. I thought we were talking about. No, he said because Diaka said Money in the Bank. Oh, well.
He said Star Wars TakeOver.
Well, scratch that. My grade is inconclusive for TakeOver. I did not watch it. As of yet.
Diakis
math?
No Diakis math here. Well, actually, there's a slight bit of Diakis math. See, my original score was a 9.99, since that's what I paid for the WWE Network. But I found this manufacturer's coupon in the mail somewhere, so it went down by 0.5 points. So now it's a 9.49, and that's my score for TakeOver The End. What? Hell yeah, man. Those things are hard to come by. Even though you can go to a website and print them off. Work in retail. Go figure. Let's go to the first match. Andrade Almas versus Ty Dillinger.
Just a little match. What was the other dude's name again?
Almas? We'll just call him Almas.
I can't say that man's name. Like, he just... I don't see it yet. And like, you know what they do when they come into NXT? They put over everything they did other places, but I'm like, shit, when you get to NXT and they change you up. He just wasn't special to me. What's the name outshined him in this match? The Perfect 10.
He's the Perfect 10.
He outshined him in this match.
I agree.
I think, and then he was over. Like, they didn't know who the other dude was, but they knew who Ty Dillinger was. And they was upset when Ty Dillinger lost his match. He was the heel. That's the only time I think this ever happened in NXT.
No, I saw the same thing. It continued that episode of NXT that came after the end, because they did a rematch, it was pretty much the same thing. They booed Almas and they cheered Ty Dillinger. So I don't know what's going on there.
No, when they did the rematch, I'm thinking they just gonna correct the mistake they made at the end and let Ty Dillinger go over. But it didn't happen. It was a great spot in that match, though.
Agreed. What do you think of his finishing maneuver?
It's pretty devastating to see somebody running at you at full speed while you're sitting in the corner. And then he just do 2 double knees to the face.
What the f...
Well, it's supposed to be to the face. Of course, he don't actually hit him in the face. But it still looked devastating.
He looked like a bulldog, like not a bulldog, but a bronco buster with knees.
Yeah. Oh,
that's what it reminds me of. What,
sitting, shining wizard?
So he's doing an old boy finisher, huh? Black Jesus. What was his name? You remember, he was in TNA. The boxer.
The Pope.
There you go.
No, it's not like that.
Burke.
It's not like that.
It's not like that, okay.
Mm-mm, it's not like that. It's like I said, it's like a Bronco Buster, right? But he runs at you with knees.
Oh.
And puts his knees in your face. Oh. And that's his finisher. It's weird.
Oh, so it's from the bottom
rope. Yeah, it's from the bottom rope.
My favorite spot in that match when Withanane, which is what I'm going to call him from now on, when Withanane did that handstand on the top rope. And Ty Dillinger super kicked him in the chin. he just went flat. I was surprised he was able to stay on the top rope as long as he was. I think he got kicked, his body just went limp.
Is this the match where the Octors of Pain debuted?
Nah,
that's next match.
Oh, yeah, right, tag team.
But I felt just like the fans in Full Sail. Ty Dillinger was over. I wanted him to win. He didn't. The other dude just don't do it for me yet.
I don't see the appeal of his character, to be honest with you.
That's how I feel. I hope he don't end up like the dude who got released. Solomon Crowe. Solomon Crowe had all that hype coming in from the indies, but he just couldn't get over.
He was an all right talent. I mean, it's just I guess it just didn't work for NXT. Not in that place and atmosphere or whatever. But whatever. Let's go to the next match: the Revival versus American Alpha for the NXT Tag Team Championship.
You know, at first with this match, I was annoyed that American Alpha lost, but I think Go Ham had said in the chat something like that. They were the right team to actually become the first two-time champions.
That's my favorite match on the card.
Yep.
And anyway, the rumors came out like that Jordan and Gable probably on their way to the main roster.
Interesting.
And then with the draft coming, and Triple H even said that he's pretty sure that they're going to rate NXT for talent for their draft. So if that happened, them boys coming up. So I knew they was taking the belts off of them, but I didn't think it was going to be that night. But like you just said, that was the only way the only team I could see beating them.
Yeah.
Until that new team debuted and beat their ass after the match. They could have did it, but...
My guys are like the Shield.
I saw clips of that beatdown, boy.
That shit was horrible.
I watched it again today.
I mean,
they were throwing Jason Jordan around like a damn ragdoll.
I mean, Taz went off on Twitter full chat. Who are you, Paul Erlen? And I'm like, Taz, I get it, but you. I said one thing I understand: that Full Sail crowd is probably full of a bunch of fans who were never around when he was relevant.
That's the thing.
I thought they were chanting, "Who are you?" at those two jackasses.
It was chanting that, what's the name? Because when he walked out, Paul Ellering, when he walked out, that's when they started doing it. But here's the thing. The last time he was seen in 1998.
Yeah, that was
18 years ago.
I'm like, most of those
kids, exactly. They're probably 14 to 15 years older than that crowd. So you want to get on them for saying, "Who are you?" Even I didn't know who he was because he don't look like he used to.
I think the only reason I even recognized him was I picture him recently as something when looking at the Road Warriors. I think that's the only reason I even recognize him, just studying stuff in the draft. Because, like I said, he don't look the same anymore.
Because I was just like, man, who the hell is that? Till Corey Graves pointed out, like, yeah, that is him. He just look much older. Because he's 18 years older.
And the Big Boss Man stood around. I bet he was like, man, why is everybody wearing my gear?
Hell yeah. Not the Authors of Pain.
But getting to this match, man. First of all, this match was the way they put it together, because at the beginning of it, Dash and Dawson, they do one thing. They're going to cut off the ring, and they're going to sing you out. They're going to beat the shit out. That's how what's-his-name wanted to start the match. He stuck one hand out to see what's-his-name was going to take the bait, and then they were going to beat the shit out of him in the corner. And he was pissed off when what's-his-name got free. That's why he tagged right out the match. And Gabriel and Jordan owned them for the first 6 minutes of the match, because you knew how the match was going to go. They were going to single out one of them, and they were going to beat the shit out of them like they do every match. Like how almost every tag team match was. But it took them 6 minutes to get to that point, because everything they tried, Jordan and Gabriel countered.
I mean, they said it was the world's greatest tag team until that point.
Then one thing I do like, every time like they do a double team move and one go for the cover, the tag team partner would go knock out the other person. That's supposed to happen in every tag match. Mm-hmm. And they did it like 7 times in this match. And I'm like, why the fuck nobody else does this shit? They're like, that's smart tag team wrestling. I'm gonna bring that up when we get to the damn Fatal 4-Way match at Money in the Bank.
Yo, don't remind me of that shit.
Because that shit was just retarded. But in this match here, like every move, that dude, high impact move, what's the name, pin, the partner gonna knock him out. I'm talking about both teams, not just the heels. The faces were doing it too.
I wish they would start doing that for real. Okay, it makes way more sense than your partner standing there just yelling encouragement from the ropes.
Yeah!
I mean, at least you can get in the ring and try kicking the pin or breaking it up.
Yeah, I never understood that either.
I like the Alpha Revival match, personally, because I like the fact it felt like an old school tag team match instead of the. I mean. Cause thanks to listening like Cornette Experience and shit like that, yeah, that's a great. I like listening to on Thursdays. It's a great podcast to listen to. But anyway, Because he got me interested in watching old Rock and Roll Express matches, Midnight Express matches, and shit like that. And watching Revival American Alpha, you can tell that they've studied their tapes quite a bit. Because it feels like a modern version of their old matches in a way.
The Rush Limbaugh of wrestling podcast.
Because fucking Gable is a lot like Morton. He's the one who catches the ass whoopings in the tag team matches. So that Jordan slash Jordan, but he's playing the Ricky Morton and what's the other fucker's name off the top of my head? But he plays that role and he gets the hot tag and goes ham.
Yeah.
Gibson, yeah, Robert Gibson. He gets the hot tag and then they just go ham.
So Titus O'Neil and Darren Young.
But man, isn't that special though? Is that Jordan took a beating too? Yeah. Right, they're single Jordan now. It wasn't until Jordan waiting on the rope to get the hot tag and go ham, which he did.
He did eventually do that.
But shit, they let Gabriel get that moment in too. Gabriel get that moment in too. He came in, he cleaned house too. Put the ankle lock on a couple of times. You know, he did his little thing. It wasn't just him taking a beam like how Kaz and Enzo, all of their matches go.
Yeah.
Enzo gonna take an ass whooping and Big Kaz gonna bail him out. That's how every match gonna go with them.
Yeah. In fairness, could you see it the other way around?
No, you can't. Enzo is just there.
Yeah, like I said, he's 7 feet tall and you can't teach that. That's how it goes.
But some of the spots in that match were real good. I like that spot. My favorite spot in this match is when Gabriel reversed that doomsday device into a belly to belly. Caught him in mid air.
Yeah, that shit was. Boy. Pretty much set that man up for the death. Sent him to the gallows, no pun intended. But, yeah.
Yeah, we'll be talking about gallows soon enough.
Sure. Then the finish is when they went for. I forgot. What do Gable and Jordan call the finish?
The Grand Aptitude.
Okay. But they went for that. What's the name? I think he knocked Gabe out of the ring. And then they put Jordan. Jordan took the pinfall in that match for the Shadow Machine.
Yeah.
Then they became two-time tag champion.
Amazing.
They're the first team to be two-time champion. Neville is the two-time tag champion.
Yeah, but the Revival's the first time as a team.
Yeah.
All right. Neville won every NXT title.
No, he never been a women's champion.
I already knew he was going.
There's only three titles of the year.
God damn it.
He won two of them.
God damn it, Nappa. I mean, he would make one other female, so you couldn't pull that off.
I mean, what is he, a hobbit? What is he? The Uggo? What?
No, he was a hobbit.
Stevie Richards, who they did wrestle women, got the women's title? Or that? No, Andy
Kaufman and fucking Hardy Whippleman.
Wait, wasn't that Bertha Faye with him?
Whatever it was, it's quite fucking disgusting. But yeah, what happened after the match?
I'm about to say we gotta talk about what happened after the match.
Somebody got the boots put on medium style.
Gabe and Jordan looked all depressed. They crying. Then some bit motherfucker came out of nowhere and laid a vicious beat down.
Where the fuck did he find these guys?
These motherfuckers are large as hell. I'm like, god damn.
Man, the rules they were doing, that shit was I'm like, man, this shit ain't even called for. I'm like, one of them picked up Gable on a sidewalk slam.
Yeah.
Dude bounced off the rope full speed and kicked him in the
head. Yeah. I'm like, god, that ain't slow. I'm like, shit.
Then they did. They finish on Jordan. Man, he closed like the shit out of Jordan to a Russian leg sweep. Oh, my god.
No damn sense.
I'm like, we gonna see these boys for months.
I see why they call the authors of pain, because they have pain written all over these niggas.
I wouldn't be shocked if next time you see Jordan and Gable, they gonna be in a draft. They gonna be going that long. They gonna be leaving this team. They ain't going back down there.
The name is looking on boys sound like something ritual to me. Authors of pain. It sounds something straight out of the group. You're 100% right. Because two big motherfuckers. His own playbook right there. All right,
yeah. Hey, I don't even know the nigga's name. I just know they the Arthur the Pain. Yeah.
So are they another big NA, big NB tag team?
Yes. Yes. That's the only way to describe them. Only thing I'm thinking about trying to look them up, but I want to see which NFL team cut these guys.
That's you, already, you already know they've been cut off from football teams. I think they were too violent.
And do they have Samoan blood?
One of them does look half Samoan or all right, something.
I think one of them do because he got that Samoan tattoo.
Yeah, I'm like, oh God. We got Samoan here.
The other one don't have no tattoo.
Let's check the lineage.
Oh God, they're breeding.
All right, let's go to the next match. Oh, they did have their first match on NXT.
It was an ass whipping.
I
was sorry for them two dudes. I don't even know who they beat.
I feel sorry for those guys, man. They didn't even get any offense in. It was just a beat down.
That shit was ugly, man.
They actually the other guy was waiting to get tired. He threw the other thing in the ring. I'm like, nah, you getting his ass with a two.
Hey, he was standing on the apron just watching the air whipping. They grabbed him and had to throw it in. He wasn't even legal. He didn't tag in or nothing. They tagged him into the ring.
They hit him with that damn, what is it, the sidewalk slam, man. Boot.
Man, you seen that ass whooping, you drop off the apron and walk back.
You tell your partner, you on your own, son.
And he didn't have a chance to run, he just threw him in the ring. He threw his ass in the ring.
I'm like, sorry, dog, that's something we just can't be part of again.
Okay.
I wonder if Vince watched that and just was like,
man, Vince is salivating.
Payne gonna be called up before
American
TLC in December, ain't it?
Yeah.
They'll be called up before TLC.
Yeah, I'm about to think probably for the end of the year.
Oh my God. Vince gets a good look at them too.
Oh yeah.
Alright. Next match. Shinsuke Nakamura versus Austin Aries.
Aries' best match so far.
The winner, I think, becomes number one contender.
No, now they're doing the number one contender shit.
Oh, I thought it was that.
But,
yeah, what I said, they never announced it was going to be number one contender.
This was a dream match.
Yeah.
All right.
And it lived up to the hype.
And Austin Aries really was taped up, but he showed he didn't favor him at all, nor did Nakamura even focus on him. He was just taped up. And then the announcers even said, like, we don't know why his real tape, though, went in the injury report. So, I guess they told it off rip, like, shit, don't even worry about that.
They were like, man, we're going to fight. We're going to worry about this later and fuck selling these ribs.
Yeah.
Right,
if you ever watched a Nakamura match, pretty much that's how that match went down.
Pretty much, yeah.
That's still a great match.
Oh, it's Nakamura. It's always going to be a great match.
I wanted that man have to pee in a cup every day.
Who?
Nakamura. I'm pretty sure Vince probably seen him like, this guy has to be on something.
He has to be on drugs. What kind of drugs are you on?
He's on a drug called Shinsuke.
That man is just
trust me, if any person that match had to get tested almost every day, I'm pretty sure it's going to be Aries. And even then, he'd probably have to pay the RVD tax every other week.
I mean, he found RVD tech on. I'm like, boy, I looked up Nakamura. I remember back in the pad when this man was coming up, like, wow. He was bland and generic as hell in the beginning. Went to Mexico, came back this crazy guy.
No. You forgot the period of time where Inoki tried to make him an MMA fighter and all this other stupid shit.
But the reason why I brought Mexico because they had these type of luchador called Exoticos. That's basically where Nakamura got his style from.
Discussing Lucha Underground, that's another story. But, what I was going to say about Shinsuke, he also was the victim of Inoki's crazy ass. Inoki is like a Japanese Vince McMahon, except possibly crazier. Less muscle fetish and more just balls out insanity.
So he's a Japanese wrestling Donald Trump?
No. He tried to, like, there was a period of time where he was trying to book New Japan as, like, a quasi-MMA
fed. Put up a wall, damn it.
Yeah.
And there's one story, I think he did this to Shinsuke, where he wasn't displaying enough fighting spirit, so he just went out there and just started beating the shit out of him for no fucking reason. Legit beat the shit out of the guy in the ring because he wasn't displaying enough fighting spirit. And I see the look on your face.
This is like, anime in real life here?
No, that's Antonio Inoki. If you don't show enough fighting spirit, he'll come out there and whoop your ass. That's one reason why New Japan almost went under in the 2000s is because of Inoki's crazy ass.
Anyway, back to this match.
Anyway.
Yeah, wrestling Donald Trump now.
But yeah, the match was great. It flowed well. Both guys showed off why they deserve to be there. And like I said, this is the first match since Austin Aries has gotten there that actually made me say, yay, Austin Aries is in NXT. Because I wish they would have signed him four years ago.
I've been saying that forever.
This is true.
But you know what? It's a good thing they waited. Because we didn't get that Austin Aries carried into TNA.
Oh, yeah.
When he went over WWE and went to TNA instead, TNA the one who gave him that.
No, WWE just straight passed him off.
Yeah.
They just said, no, we're not interested.
Yeah, I wonder why.
Because he is an asshole. He was considered too small at the time, and he was an asshole.
So I was didn't want two CM Punks on the same roster. that's all they said about CM Punk. He was just an asshole. He was a crybaby.
CM Punk was more endearing, though, than Austin Aries. Austin Aries was an asshole, but he was the kind you just want to beat the shit out of.
Yeah, but Triple H wanted to beat the shit out of CM Punk, but CM Punk eventually, I guess, lighting up. And on the beginning, nobody liked him because he was such an asshole back there.
Yeah.
Well, except Paul Heyman.
And of course, JTG included this in the book, too, about CM Punk trying to screw him over.
That's another story. But Austin Aries, yeah, and also, then again, he made TNA completely watchable for his period of time during when he was on top.
His drugs. Run, yeah.
Yeah.
Lots of drugs. Anyway.
I only remember really two spots in the match. Like I said, the Nakamura match is almost good as that thing.
I'm still surprised this man is in WWE.
Psych up Kinshasa.
Kinshasa.
I don't know that name of that.
Yeah, the Bumaini is so much better.
I'm just glad he's in the Kinshasa.
I don't think that Corey Gray sell it right. But Corey Gray do a lot of things right.
I'm glad this right. WWE I'm glad WWE at least kept the homage to the name. So at least it's still relevant for where it came from.
Oh, it still translates to kill him knee or
no? It's the name of the city where name of the stadium where Muhammad Ali and them fought.
Oh, so what is it? Kinshasa, the move that beat John Cena, or a knee trembler? Which one is it?
Kind of a knee trembler.
Okay. It's sort of, yeah.
It's kind of in the middle. It's kind of like a Shining Wizard knee trembler.
Yeah, it's like in the middle. I remember the finish though. I remember Austin Aries did the suicide dive and hit him down. Barricade. I'm gonna kill himself.
Then, so he was trying to take out Lincoln too.
Then Nakamura did the knee off the middle rope.
Yeah.
And then finish him off with the whatever.
Kinshasa.
Kinshasa! Tom Phillips fell it pretty good too.
That's the thing about that rip knee Sasha Banks in the head. Tom Kinshasa.
I heard about that. That shit pissed me off. But I ain't forgetting.
Next match! Speaking of another Japanese starlet, Asuka versus Nia Jax for the NXT Women's Championship.
Nia Jax surprised me.
I loved in that too.
I'll say this about Nia Jax. I got to give her props for the fact that
you would die.
She has improved by leaps and bounds ever since she came up. Although I did like her partnership with Eva Marie, it was great. But at the same time, she has shown a lot of improvement and she held her own.
Yay.
Yeah, they were much legit. She looked
because they took basically. Asuka took the formula that Bayley used because you can't really lift a bit. So they keep putting in submissions. It didn't work till Asuka just said, "I'm gonna just keep kicking it. I'm gonna keep kicking in the head."
I mean, that also works.
It worked well. You kicked in the head three times to finish up.
to quote my favorite commentary, my girl in my Fake Five, she won this match.
I don't know, we're talking about kicking in the head.
I don't think Booker
had nothing to do with what.
Well, her finisher is Tajiri's kicking the head. Or
no,
she used a running kick strike thing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And I like the very end where Nia Jax on her knees and she just screamed at Asuka and bam, and that's the end.
Yeah, she just kicked her in the face.
She went down like a Samoan.
Although she's been knocking people out with a roundhouse kick in.
Although I'm not gonna lie, when Nia did that roar, it would have been freaking awesome. She would have catched that kick and picked her up and powerbombed the shit out of her, and I would have accepted that as the end. I would accept like she screamed and like kind of like hulked out and just like picked her up and powerbombed the shit out of Asuka and won the title. I would have accepted that finish too.
You know what?
Speaking of powerbombs, that should be your finisher. Fuck that leg drop. That power bomb she does, that needs to be her finisher.
Yeah, she like the leg drop. She can keep it. She just can't finish nobody off with
it. I refer to start doing the leg drop because of Hogan.
You know what? I take the back.
Your spine.
She can finish people off with it, but that shouldn't be in her finisher.
Well, the fact is that Bayley ate like eight of them and it didn't finish her off.
Don't give me start on that match.
They fought on NXT and it did finish her off.
Yeah, but I'm talking about when it mattered. When it mattered, Bayley went all female Cena and ate eight of them or something like that.
She ate three to the back of the head and kicked out. And I'm like, okay, Bayley has transformed to Super Bayley.
I mean, Bayley was like, shit, that move ain't about shit. You know, I ain't losing no fucking leg drop.
I mean, why?
The reason she lost the second time, because they told the story. She was injured.
Of course, because of Hogan, I'm like, I know since Nia Jax had way more padding than Hogan. I really don't like that leg drop being used that often.
But like I was going to say, NXT got a huge problem. Asuka's a monster. There's nobody on that goddamn roster that could beat her but Bayley. And Bayley's not going to do it. So,
Bayley already lost.
That don't mean she can't beat Asuka.
Nope, she ain't.
I know she's not. I'm saying she's the only one who can.
I mean, she's busy making her boyfriend jealous with Finn, so.
The point is that NXT got a fucking problem. Asuka's going to be champion until she retires.
They're
going
to have a bigger problem in about a month. Yep. When they
cut
them.
But yeah. Hopefully they call up Asuka.
Possibly. The only person that probably could take her down is probably...
Eva Marie.
No.
Probably
Athena. Eventually.
Yeah, that's what the that's most what people saying. Now, if Eva Marie took down Asuka,
that's the thing. That's gonna be a long road to do that.
That's a long road to get there. Yeah.
No, but if Eva Marie did dethrone Asuka, I would love to be a Full Sail when this happens because I just want to just drink all the. Actually, I want to have me a box of French fries with me. And I wonder how much they can salt my fries for me.
Shut up, Fat Dean Ambrose. Anyway, next match, main event time.
I should grow some facial hair and I would be at Owens.
For real. Nah, you should start wearing a wife beater and some jeans.
I don't like wearing jeans, though.
I don't like wearing jeans either. Fuck it. Anyway, Samoa Joe versus Finn.
I got my red
steel cage match for the NXT Championship.
That muscle buster at the end.
First of all, they built this match up. They 7 months they built this match up, and it ain't still yet. That's how you build up feuds.
And it was so simple, too.
Yeah, simple way. Because first of all, they ain't always had to directly feud with them. Samoa Joe had to get through Sami Zayn just to get back at Joe. Not Joe, at Finn. So it worked out.
Yeah.
Then he kept losing. Then his one title, when he finally win the title, we don't get to see it. I think he should have lost in Dallas. Finn should have lost in Dallas. But no. WWE. Look, the main roster even fucked up NXT at that time because they didn't know what the fuck was going on. So Triple H, like, alright, we keep tight on Finn. Joe about to leave. Then Apollo Crews the one who go up. Like, oh shit.
What?
like, okay. Well, like, we can get a title to Joe now. But this match was pretty good for a cage match. Because I'm one of the matches I hate now, a cage match.
Once again, I think, Finn Balor's first one I showed about Samoa Joe, so I'm like...
First of all, Samoa Joe wrestled in that company in Florida, so he's been in a cage
I've never heard of this company in Florida.
Yeah, that's why I'm not sure Samoa Joe.
But I heard that company in Florida's WrestleMania-like event was better than WWE's WrestleMania for this year.
WWE should shoot himself for that.
Well, of course, it featured the greatest man to ever live, a broken Matt Hardy versus Brother Nero. Concept, you have to watch this.
You need to watch
Brother Nero.
I haven't watched it.
I mean, The Rock. I mean,
you are
depriving yourself.
I would not support TNA Bad Habit.
It's every bad habit all in one, though.
To the match.
I didn't see it.
Match was awesome.
Yeah, I did like this match.
And why you said at the beginning, the finish this match was just, I was scared as hell.
I have a huge beef for this.
One of my favorite wrestlers can never wrestle again because of this move, and he decided to do it off the second rope. I was frightened. I like Finn.
It worked out fine, but WWE, y'all use that black cage, I think, with Ambrose and Lesnar, or Ambrose and Jericho. Please stop using that silver cage. That thing is distracting as hell.
I was just about to say, that wasn't a black cage, wasn't it? Because the whole time I'm thinking NXT was going to do theirs in the black cage. I'm like, because you know, it kind of blend in all that black and yellow and now, well, black and white. Mm-hmm. But it would just work with a black cage.
That silver cage is too damn shiny.
Yeah.
Because with Ambrose and Jericho, you didn't really know the cage that much since it's black.
Douchebag cage.
Even, matter of fact, even the old school blue cage would have been better than that silver one. But that's my only real beef with that match.
I have no beef with this match.
When they said it was going to be escape, I was like, they're going to just let Joe walk out the cage and to protect Finn from never losing. But they actually let him pin the demon.
You thought, I ain't think that all. Like, NXT, they're going to have a, they're going to make sure it's going to be a straightforward. What the fuck?
Yeah, but when you have the escape the cage rule, because they didn't have to have that. They could have said, let's just make me pin the submission. But they kept the escape from the, so I was like, you can have Joe walk out and beat Finn and protect the demon. I'm glad they went with what they did. The demon needed to be beat.
I mean, I ain't think they're going to have him escape the cage. Kind of like, this is an NXT, I ain't think he was going to escape. Matter of fact, when was the last time they had an escape anyway? Even on both rosters. I mean, just a clean escape, not any interference escapes.
Have they ever? The main roster, a cage match ain't nothing but... No, Seth Rollins. Seth Rollins beat Randy Orton. They escape.
Wait, yeah. Did a Kane interfere? Or Lesnar? Somebody? Did somebody interfere in that?
Yeah, you're right.
Because
Seth did the SKO, the move that was supposed to be banned in that match.
Yeah.
And then he won.
Oh, that afterward, he was trying to stay in the cage and Brock just came in there. Either way. I don't think anybody ever escaped from the cage cleanly before.
Yeah, but they could have went there right this way. They let the demon get pinned, which was good because it had to happen sooner or later.
Well, Finn, you getting called up soon.
But not until he faces Nakamura. I can't wait to see that shit.
Mm-hmm. Another dream.
I wonder if they're going to save it for Brooklyn. That's kind of a long way out.
August?
Yeah.
Ooh, that is a while.
I think it's like toward the end of August that day.
Woo, that's
a long way to hold this match that you already basically said it's going to happen. I'm thinking that they're going to do it sooner or later because Finn probably might get drafted. So they'll probably do it like within the next 2-3 weeks on regular NXT TV. Finn take a L on their way out like everybody does in NXT. Then he get called up. Then we can go to Nakamura Joe in Brooklyn.
Ooh, that's going to be fun.
I can't wait to see that one too.
And then Joe's probably going to eat the L, and then he's going to be on SmackDown or Raw.
Yep.
And I cannot wait.
Then Nakamura, I hope, will break Finn Balor's record. Unless he get called up, then.
And I hope he get drafted to where they'll show Cena on. I want to see Cena Nakamura.
I also want to see Cena Nakamura.
I wish we could see Cena Okada.
That
would be fun.
The only Japanese wrestler I want Cena take on is Tanahashi.
That's what I meant to say.
But then again, that match would never end because both refused to lose.
Dude, that sounds like a great match, dude. There'd be so many false finishes. That'd be a fucking match where false finishes, it don't fucking matter because they do false finish anyway. Yeah. So it'd be fucking great.
That match could be the whole fucking pay-per-view because you have the unlosable object versus the unbeatable wrestler.
So we'll have
wrestling money in vain. I'm gonna say this. That match, when the pin actually happened, it would catch you off guard because you would expect to never false finishes the entire match. So when somebody hit a move, oh, he kicking out.
Tanahashi's gonna kick out of two. Cena kicks out of two.
So when the three count actually happened, you'd be like, oh shit, he stayed there for three? Alright, go ahead.
Yeah, but the other problem is you might get bored after a while and be like, okay, I'm gonna grab a sandwich, and that's when the fucking three count's gonna happen. Because after 30 minutes goes by, it inevitably turns into like an hour long match. You're just like, fuck it, I'm gonna grab a sandwich, and then that's when the fucking match is gonna
happen. They have to give that match a time limit.
It'll be like this. You be putting the mayonnaise on it.
Fuck, I missed the ending.
Basically, make that match the second hour main event, and the final hour.
Because if it happened in WWE, Cena winning.
Cena by home court advantage.
Oh, shit.
Now, if it happened, especially in Japan, Cena's losing.
Oh, my God, that was funny.
Because we don't need Japanese to start rioting anymore.
Oh, it can't happen in Japan. Because we'll hit every fucking call that Cena make. Throw me over there. That quiet ass crowd, we'll definitely hear that shit.
AD English, loud as hell, too. Oh, man, all y'all went to the AAA school of calling the match.
How the dude don't ingest him in dog!
I hate to bring this up, but that match they were talking, everybody been complaining about Ospreay versus Ricochet. I watched that match. That's all you heard was spot calling. Because it was so quiet and everything had to be done so perfectly the way they were wrestling.
I haven't seen it yet.
I seen it.
I had to watch it. I got tired of him.
Was it bad?
It was enjoyable, but I understand what Vader said. It's just too it's just too scripted.
Jim Cornette said it perfect. It wasn't a wrestling match. It wasn't.
Vader described it as a gymnastics.
That's what it was. At one point, this is what made me mad about the match. And it's the only thing that made me mad. When they were doing all that little gymnastic shit, there was one part where they both looked at each other. Then they both went different direction, bounced off the rope, did a handspring, and did a back flip and looked at each other. I'm like, y'all ain't even trying to hit each other right now.
Yeah, I saw that clip on Hollywood.
That shit right there, I'm like, no.
Wait, it went that far? Yeah. It went that far with the ESPN?
Yes, it was on Highly Questionable. They showed a clip on CCO. No. I was like, oh my goodness.
Man, at one point, they wasn't even trying to attack each other. That what got me.
It was entertaining, but like, boy, this is no. This just makes it too obvious. And like the person said, man, y'all wouldn't even try to touch each other. Like, okay.
And then what made it real obvious, like the point, the reason I even brought up this match, because it's in Japan and the crowd is so quiet, you heard every spot they call. And I'm like, okay, y'all just you took me out of the match with this shit.
All right,
but Money in the Bank.
Money in the Bank. Let's get some scores.
NA.
NA as well.
Why are we going NA?
7.8.
Because I only watched those three matches that mattered. Well, I watched four of them.
Well, it was a three match show.
Exactly.
I watched it, but I don't really have a score because I wasn't really paying that much attention.
Understand?
Man, the undercard was horrible. One of them matches made me want to watch it. I was like, I'm going to watch the New Day because it's the New Day. You got the New Day and Kaz and Enzo. And then I like Gallows and Anderson. So I was like, okay, I'm going to watch this match. But everything else, I don't want to see.
New Day Ross.
I hate Sheamus and Apollo Crews bored the hell out of me. Baron Corbin, Dolph for the 19th time.
Yeah.
That was actually good one.
I heard.
That was really good.
Too bad I watched it 5 times before that.
Yeah.
Just couldn't do it no more.
Why is it always pre-show?
They actually made it to the main roster this time.
Oh, they moved the one.
And then, of course, Charlotte,
we'll get to that when we get to
the tag match went exactly how you'd expect.
Exactly, so.
So, you have an NA? Do we have 2 NA so far?
I can't read
the scorecard. We're really paying attention.
I can't go up if you only watch 3 matches.
The concept. What was your score again?
7.8.
Okay.
I'd say 9.
But you know what? Go by just them 3 matches, I'll give you a 9 too. That's the highest the WWE pay-per-view score has got for me yet. But if I will go back and watch the other match, I'm pretty sure it's going to drop. But it was a 3 match show. All 3 of those matches delivered. I wasn't disappointed. It was better than on the end to me.
Funny, you and Albert I heard say that.
So and maybe I love NXT.
Maybe you seen the other match that might be good. I heard folks saying that who watched the whole show, but I'm like,
the August math time. Oh, sorry.
Yeah. Oh,
okay. Oh shit. Let me see here. Pre-show. The whole pre-show gets a -15,000. Because none of those goddamn matches mattered. Fuck the free show. Fuck those 2 matches. Fuck the tag teams that were in those 2 matches. Except for the Dudley Boys. But fuck that shit. Didn't make any fucking sense. And what's this bullshit I heard that Kalisto was supposed to be in Money in the Bank, but they used the wrong damn graphic? What kind of fucking shit is that?
That's some TNA shit.
Yeah. Uh-oh. Get your shit straight.
Kevin Dunn fired somebody.
Speaking of Kevin Dunn, I saw his dumb ass on the fucking on that fucking press release. Another -15,000 bullshit for the draft. If the draft even happened, it's getting a -15,000 points because it's bullshit.
It just look nice.
Yeah, they don't work though. all right, the Fatal 4-Way match. Let me see here. The New Day promo that by itself gets a damn 1.5 million points. Cause that shit was awesome, and they buried everyone in there. Everybody. G&A just being there and all their damn Japanese shit, that gets 500,000 points because they're awesome.
The Vaughn villains, fuck them. -15,000 points. And let me see. Oh, Enzo and Cass delivering that beautiful ass promo. Oh, man. 1.5 million for points for that shit, too. God damn.
Oh, yeah. I'm giving New Day 500 points because then they also partied with Kevin Love, who wore an Austin 316 shirt.
Oh, that gets... I get plus 3.16 million points for me, god damn it. Woo!
Still a damn turnstile.
Anyway, yeah. He can't play defense worth shit. Whatever. Anyway, Corbin versus Ziggler. How many times have I seen this damn match? How many times you say, go ham?
I said 19.
19? Negative 19 million points then. No, I'm not gonna give it 19 negative 19 million points though. I'll probably say negative 1.9 million. The match was good, don't get me wrong. The match was good. Because it showed Baron Corbin is not only a fucking powerhouse, but he also has some agility too. And he actually saved Dolph Ziggler in one spot, so I have to give some props to Baron Corbin for saving Dolph Ziggler. But this rivalry, I hope it's fucking dead. Just like, whatever. People, whatever.
Dead like Jerry Lawler's career?
Maybe. Or Roman Reigns title reign. You see what I did there? You see what I did there? Foreshadowing, motherfucker. All right. Charlotte. Okay. -15 million points. I ain't even gonna get into that bullshit. Fuck that match. And the betrayal at the end. We'll add 15 million points back. So that's just end over. Apollo Crews versus Sheamus. I thought it was a pretty solid match. +15 points. Whatever. AJ Styles versus John Cena. Okay, match was awesome. Match was awesome. I had no problem with the finish. The only problem I had was fucking JBL. His bitch ass kept on going on and on and on and on about... Let me put it like this. How the hell are you going to be a heel commentator and you're going to start saying face shit after the fucking match? JBL, you get a negative 3 million points. The match gets a plus 15 million points. Okay? Dean Ambrose winning Money in the Bank. Yeah, whatever. 20 million points, I guess. Whatever. Rusev. That promo we cut on Titus O'Neil's kids.
Your father's a loser! Happy Father's Day!
Chris Wall would be proud of that shit.
Damn. Titus O'Neil's son need to be suspended for 60 days too for slapping Rusev. Only Lana gets to slap Rusev.
just for that little thing. A little promo at the end. I have to get this plus 1,500 points. Why not? Seth Rollins versus Roman Reigns. I really enjoyed this match. I saw a switch between Seth Rollins playing a babyface, wrestling as a babyface. I saw Roman Reigns wrestle as a heel. Really good shit. Roman Reigns tried to take out Bacon, that barricade or whatever. He saw Bacon. I swear he did. He saw Bacon. He tried to take him out. He was trying to save everybody's injuries. For the rest of 2016, unfortunately, he failed miserably. Like, just like he failed that damn piss test. But that's not the point. I have to give this match right here a plus 10 million points because it was great. And Dean Ambrose cashing in at the end. Oh, man. 100 million points. So overall, I have to give this pay-per-view. Originally, I said on my Diakas review, I gave this pay-per-view an 8.9. I'm going to have to change that score. Because now I have to change it back to an 8.8. Because I will say this. The main thing that I looked over was the entire... The undercard sucked. The undercard was just straight garbage. I can't give it an 8.9. Because if I were to give it a 9, that'd be my perfect score since it's not a big 4 pay-per-view. Understood? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, good. I'm glad y'all understand because most people have much I don't. Alright, that's the end of Diakas math. Continue on.
Let's talk about these matches in more
Alright, let's get the pre-show.
Well, go to the three matches that Gohan cared about.
Yeah, fuck these other matches.
No, I'm talking about...
Let's at least talk about the...
Yeah, the
promo.
Yeah, that.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Well,
we can talk about the promo.
Wasn't it
one of the matches you cared about, though?
I watched it. See? Man, you called... Freaking Big E called the Vaughn villains a monopoly, man. He don't know whether they should go to jail or do something else.
A Pasco and collect $200. Yeah, this shit was funny as fuck. God damn.
And then they said they show Gallows and Anderson, why they're the elite.
The elite
tag team.
Yeah. Damn. That's fucked up.
I like how the crowd went, ooh. Like, they, even they know what's up.
Damn, that's fucked up.
And I think Kofi said some pretty weak stuff about Enzo.
No, nah, but because he said he looked like Han Solo
and Chewbacca.
Yeah. That hair was Chewbacca. That hair was Chewbacca.
Okay, Xavier killed me with that shit. That shit was so funny.
Oh, all three of them teams, like,
that shit was so funny.
They won't make it worse, man. They roasted all three of these teams before the match. Then they beat them.
Yeah.
New Day?
I see why they went to the Wyatt's next, because none of those teams deserve a shot. Yeah.
Okay.
That was a New Day I ain't seen in a while, though, since they turned face. Yeah. That was the heel New Day.
That was the heel New Day that are no longer heels.
And WWE, I guess, you know, it only lasts for one day. I guess they're like, Wyatt's going face. Let's forget that ever happened.
Just like Seth Rollins. When people want to cheer Seth Rollins, fuck that.
Yeah.
Before we get into that, the whole New Day Wyatt thing, I have one thing about to say about this match. It got really confusing near the end.
Oh, yeah, that was a clusterfuck. That was the only downside of that match.
Some referees.
Thanks a lot, Teddy.
It was even refereeing. Well, it was refereeing screwing up. God damn it. Anyway, referees had something to do with it, but it was more like placement. Because I think, Gallows and Anderson just hit the Magic Killer, right? Yeah. On, was it Aiden English? One of those fucking guys, I don't fucking know. I can't tell them apart.
Yeah, Aiden.
It was either Aiden English or Simon Gotch, whatever. Who cares? Okay, it was English. Fucking, they were about to count, the referee was about to count 1, 2, and then Big E just picks up fucking Anderson like a fucking paper doll or whatever, and he just holds him. And there's Gallows just standing there like, duh, what the fuck you do here?
Gallows was against the rope just doing like this, like, I should attack him, that would be smart, but I'm supposed to get kicked right now.
The thing was, I think Cass was fucking out of position, yeah, like was, a motherfucker.
He was late as fuck. I honestly think he should have, I think he was supposed to kick Gallows out the ring before the save.
Yeah.
Uh-oh. That would have made more sense.
Yeah, and,
Kofi was supposed to hit Trouble in Paradise on,
Yeah, that's another box right there.
Enzo, but he fell down. So instead, he just DDT'd him, I believe.
Man, what is
some crazy shit?
Yeah, he's smoking what Romo smoking on to get suspended.
I thought he was trying to go for that Ranhei he used to do.
The SOS.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah,
I think he did.
He was trying to go for that, but I didn't go too well.
Go ahead. No, I'm just gonna skip.
Cass's big boot he did at the very end was pretty
he just
sick.
Clocked him. Yeah,
it was late as fuck, but it made it.
It finally made it.
Then they hit the what they call it the midnight hour.
The midnight hour, the midnight hour on.
They hit it on the legal man in the match, which was Anderson.
Yeah,
but they didn't pin Anderson.
Yeah, he went in the.
They pinned English, who was tagged by Anderson.
Yeah, but he got hit by the Magic Killer earlier, so I'm surprised he didn't kick out because he was dead. He rested. In my theory, he rested for a little bit. So if he would have kicked out, that'd been fine.
Yeah, that move was strong as hell. That's right.
That's move. Hey, you kicked out Johnson.
I was about to say, but Cena. Casino would die for a long time.
Straight out of Japan.
By transitive property, that means Roman Reigns is the most powerful character. Roman Reigns kicked out.
I think because he kicked out, I don't know. I'm going to put video game knowledge into this shit. I guess everybody starts off with a higher toughness during an Extreme Rules match. Or higher resiliency.
Everybody's durability goes up one.
Yeah, like 20 points or some shit. That's what I'm thinking, so. That's why he kicked out all that shit. Now, if it was a regular match, no, he wouldn't have kicked out all that shit. Well, yeah, maybe he would have, because the steroids would have told him to kick out.
And don't forget, Roman's got to look strong.
Mm-hmm.
That's an extra 100 points.
Yeah, resiliency. Yeah.
Never mind. That's
next match was Corbin versus Ziggler. Took forever at the beginning. Finally picked up towards the end. And that's about all I got to say about that. The crowd chant is boring.
That one's boring.
During the part where I was talking about it was slow during the beginning, yeah, that was
pretty boring. That's different.
He was working AAA. He was working.
Damn.
He was working in between Triple H and Randy Orton pace. That was what Corbin was working. So yeah, I can see
how he's working. He said in between Triple H. I think he has his own pace days after.
That's different from NXT pace. NXT pace is injured in 30 seconds. Corbin got better, but he's slipping. He ate off 12 minutes.
He gave him a short arm Irish whip and fucking in a day's ass. I'm getting in the match.
Hold on. That's for 12 minutes.
Yeah, it was. I told you it picked up towards
the night. Why the fuck these matches were going so long? That's why we went 20 minutes off the goddamn time.
Like the last 5 minutes. That's when it picked up.
It's funny. They were like, man, WWE, man, why you pay per views can end early? This one goes way over.
People still complaining. Fuck them niggas.
I can go to work in the morning.
I had to go to work in the morning. Shit.
Well, what the fuck you want to do? End early? End on time?
These bitch ass niggas got nothing to complain about.
Yeah, I know. They
let me explain this. I get done watching pay-per-view. I send y'all niggas out. I record my damn video at the shit. Get done at 12:46. Go to sleep. Have to wake up at 4 o'clock in the morning to go to work. Y'all motherfuckers ain't got no goddamn excuse. Shut the fuck up.
Y'all ain't paying $50 or whatever it is.
Yeah, they could at least end it at 10:59. I mean, they end SmackDown on time.
Who is that? That's three quarters. Who is still paying for this on pay-per-view?
Well,
hey, even if you're not paying for it, I want to end at 11 o'clock.
Probably, no, I mean, I'm just curious. Who the hell is still paying?
Everybody can't
Well, not, not everybody got
Probably,
Xbox.
Not or, even Xbox.
Or a computer.
Or smart. Everybody has a fucking smartphone, though.
I mean, you can get a smartphone for Dollar General, download WWE app. I mean,
you can get TiVo.
My thing
is, it's on TiVo now.
Well, let me see. I'm trying to think. Maybe restaurants.
Yeah.
Or probably. Bars or some shit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it is cheaper to buy a WWE network just for that shit. I mean,
yeah.
I mean, you come out over.
Can a bar and just buy the network?
That's what I'm thinking. Yeah.
Even if they spend the full $50 on that, make that shit back in no time.
Yeah, okay. That's true.
But they can make the $9.99 back in 2 drinks.
Yeah. That's true. But anyway, what were we talking about?
The in charge extra.
We're talking about some match that.
Can we skip this match then?
What was the end?
I can't remember how it ended. All I know
was the end of the Dolph Ziggler tried to be cheeky. He got fucking fucked up in the end of days and it's over.
Yeah.
Alright. Dolph is dead to me. WWE, you've tried for years to kill Dolph Ziggler. You succeeded.
All it took was Rusev and Baron Corbin.
I think he's been dead before that.
Dolph was dead to me before then.
Dolph was dead to me when he fucked up that storyline. I'm like, okay, the storyline sucked. But Rusev and Summer Rae and Lana making great work out of this crap. Dolph, you just dragging ass when this is a storyline that you should excel in.
No, you know when Dolph died to me? When he got fired. Because that was stupid as hell. They had a chance to make that man a star and they decided to keep him on TV a month. I was like, okay, y'all fucking retarded. Dolph come back, they put him in the room, but he don't do shit. He was in it for 2 minutes. So, y'all don't care about him, I shouldn't either.
Oh, you mean that time when he went ham on Survivor Series?
Yeah. That was his time. They fucked it up. All
right, then the next match
was dead.
Was a tag match.
I blame Triple H for burying him.
The next match was a tag match. It should have just been a one-on-one match for the title.
I don't want to talk about this match, except for the end.
No, that's what I was going to do. Dana Brooke and Charlotte won, obviously.
Hey,
of course.
Guess when I found out that Becky turned heel. I mean, not Becky. She was supposed to. I read that this morning.
Yes.
When Natty turned heel. When she jumped the last night. I was like, what the fuck did this happen? I would listen to the promo. I was like, what?
Yeah.
Damn, what's the name came and knocked the shit out of her. I was like,
Natty,
what the fuck out of you? And then when she said what he said, I was like, okay, that makes sense. You have been taking care of a lot of people.
But yeah, she beat the shit out of Becky, though, man.
I gotta go watch the beating.
Those punches were way more believable than Dana Brooks' punches, period.
Becky Lynch is this female Sting.
Actually, no, there needs to be a contest between Bayley and Becky Lynch. The contest is who's the new female Sting. First person to betray the other one, the one who gets betrayed is the new is female Sting.
Well, Becky's getting betrayed.
See, Becky already has a damn head start. All you have to do is take off her goggles and reveal it's her, and it's over.
All she has to do is say, help me. And somebody
help me!
Bayley gonna Bayley? Bailey plexing everybody. But Charlotte ain't gonna turn face.
Oh shit.
Help me. Sasha's not gonna help.
Sasha's a tweener.
God damn it, too, they.
Help me.
I will never ever forget that. He beat up his own group, man. His own group.
Just got speaks here. Help me.
Help me. He turned around and looked at the crowd and hopped up and beat the shit out of his own group.
My favorite moment.
He told him to do it in the first
place. No. Or what about the time when Hogan quit and Dixie's just grabbing on his leg? No, leave. Hogan's like, I'm out here, brother. You're out of money, bro, Jack.
I did my job, brother.
Well, shit. Yes, I killed another wrestling company.
Yeah. Now I'm going to kill Dick.
Well, shit. The President Dawkins should have yelled, help me before Hogan finished. Help me. Hogan buried WCW, TNA, and Dawkins.
She's no longer Thought Steiner because Steiner hates fucking Flair, so she's now like Charlotte's Muff Bagwell now.
Muff Bagwell. I'm done.
They make Dana look like the dumbest woman in the world. She was smart when she was with Emma.
She was?
She was really smart.
Nah, she do a fuck up for Charlotte. That's how Sasha gonna beat Charlotte. Dana gonna do the dumbest shit ever, and Sasha's gonna win.
I think the difference is Charlotte's blonde is rubbing off on him.
Then that bitch would be going, it was my bad. I did fuck up. But that ain't her words. But that was she might have was.
So you trade out Nate for Dana Brooke, and Dana Brooke is fucking up.
I know. It Brie Bell all over me.
I just want to see Dana Brooke. I just like when she flexes her arms. I don't know.
I just rather look at Dana Brooke than Ric Flair's old crutch. Woo!
I just hate what they're doing. She was perfect with Emma.
Agreed.
Yeah, but Emma got injured. Dana was great, with Emma, because they were a great package together.
Yeah, they played off each other well.
Yeah. Oh, that's what
one
a good...
One was in the ring, the other one good on the mic. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say that. And the fact is that Dana, since they are like, okay, we're bringing her to the main roster.
Wait, ain't both of those Emma?
No.
No.
Well,
you
Dana...
You said good on the ring and the mic?
Dana's better on the mic. She's got her character down pat.
Dana, yeah, she's better than Emma.
Emma's great in the ring, but Emma got injured, so Dana, they're like, oh, she's on the main roster now, so, fuck, what do we do with her?
Yeah, she was brought up to be with Emma, and Emma got hurt, so they're like, man, what are we going to do with
And her? Because the women's division, Charlotte's pretty much the queen bitch, and Sasha's a tweener, and, so they just...
No bailing.
Hey, man, this women's division sucks right now.
No yeah. bailing.
Charlotte's the only thing good about it. Everybody else.
They only revolve around. I know you can't push everybody at once, but they only revolve around four people. Really.
It's kind of like back with the Divas. There's only one. You're only allowed one, maybe two storylines.
I can't believe I'm saying
it. It's just the time they're given.
This would be perfect for the Bella Twins. I can't believe I just said this.
Yeah, Reese not coming back anytime soon. Nikki's probably is, but Nikki's not gonna be. I'm not sure where New Fisher is.
Yeah, she said she retired the record test.
She said something like that Comic Con or something like that that she has something she's gonna show off.
So I know what she needs to do. She needs to do the
attitude adjustment.
It's a shame. It was gonna say the Brie mode stunner, but okay.
I think I would fuck it up even worse.
I think she's gonna turn that spine buster to her finisher.
I say this though, like,
or that forearm.
Charlotte, at the rate I guess you can't say she's gonna break the record because they changed the belt out, but she's gonna be champion longer than Nikki at this rate, and her reign is not shit. Like Nikki Van AJ. They ran with shit. Charlotte wrestled every pay-per-view. And majority of all pay-per-views, she defended the title. She only then defended the title twice. Because one time she wasn't even a champion. And the last time was, last pay-per-view. Yeah.
But
every other time she defended the title.
Yeah, but AJ Lee had the title. What competition did she have?
Same as Nikki.
What competition Charlotte had? Now, the triple threat match, yes, and Becky, but besides that,
because
they made Nat, they've been killing Natty off.
Triple H basically protecting the hell out of Sasha.
Sasha's yanking that off.
Looked like the referee tried to protect her.
Kiss Sasha.
Sasha claimed that shit.
I can't let you get jobbed out here. You should be back in town for SummerSlam.
Although, it would be hilarious.
Well,
that,
she grabbed that tussle. She gonna do something.
You know what would be cool is that, like, Asuka showed up and then Dana Brooke just completely just goes,
next match!
And, like, has, like, PTSD seeing Asuka.
All I was gonna say is they're probably gonna do Sasha and Charlotte at Battleground. Now, this draft kind of fucked things up. Mate, Battleground, awesome, though.
They did say chances are the women time might be between both shows. I think they have a smaller roster.
That's not what I'm talking about, though. Oh. I'm talking about they're probably gonna do the match now instead of hold it off to SummerSlam.
Oh,
Unless they do another fucking tag match.
Or unless, of course, like, Sasha almost wins but gets Dusty finished or something like that, and then they can do it at SummerSlam.
Yeah, rematch and then give
you Stone will beat her ass. That's what's gonna happen.
Next match was Sheamus versus Terry Crews. I mean, Apollo Crews.
Explosions!
Explosion! My bad. I always get that confused.
Super happy black man.
How long did this match go?
I think it went,
8 minutes?
Yeah.
8 minutes too long.
Sheamus' new Titantron is cool looking, I'm not gonna lie.
I thought it was a pretty solid match.
Yeah, I liked it. It was alright for me.
No, I'm talking about the match even happening.
See, I have no problem with the match happening. It actually has a storyline to it.
Yeah, you need somebody to help.
I mean,
help give Apollo the rug.
I mean, here's the thing. Okay.
He's green as fuck.
I'd say more bland
than anything.
Yeah, he's more bland than anything. You know?
Well, I mean, should say
his ass wounds. You say bland.
I'm gonna say this though. Most of this undercard even happened because you put all your guys in the Money in the Bank match. So, because that's what made Extreme Rules and Payback so good.
I just had an effed up quote. As dark as Apollo is, he sure is white meat.
I'm gonna fucking kill you.
I mean,
well, white meat is pretty bland. I mean,
that's what.
Unless you put barbecue sauce on it, I mean, no point in eating the white meat.
Lemon pepper,
the chicken. Even then, it's dry. But back to the base.
Put some General Tso on that shit.
Back
to the base. Sheamus hit a second rope white noise. That was pretty cool.
I call the Irish cross one.
And that's what led to the end of the match. Because that's all I remember.
He knows all that shit and crucifixed him.
Yeah, he crucified Apollo Crews. He made a fucking too, and then crucifixed.
He made a fucking heel mistake.
Yep,
and he paid for it. That's all it is.
But no, all he did was complain to the ref for being too slow.
That's a heel mistake.
After watching the NBA Finals, I understand why. I can see why he complained to the ref.
Instead of giving Apollo the rub and having him just beat the man. They decided to protect Sheamus by having him get beat by fucking a suffer.
Yeah.
It's a heel tactic.
Is it?
I mean, that's how Dolph, well, in this case, how Dolph beat Corbin. Corbin showed off, Dolph hit with that zigzag.
But, yeah, you can say that, but what I take out of the match is that Apollo couldn't beat Sheamus unless Sheamus beat himself.
I mean, I guess, but...
Or Sheamus would say, I beat myself.
But Sheamus didn't, Sheamus didn't beat him. Sheamus bitching at the ref. Sheamus should have paid attention.
But, you know, I don't give a fuck about either one of them, but I would think that you would just have Apollo beat him and say, hey, Apollo, he beat Sheamus because Sheamus is a former world champion.
Yeah, but
they're going to say that anyway, but look at how he beat him.
Yeah.
That means it keeps the feud going. And I guess Sheamus' excuse, but Sheamus got beat.
But, dang it.
If he didn't want to lose, all he had to do was kick out.
Yeah, but the thing about it, they could have did that anyway. They could have kept the feud going regardless.
Yeah, they can end feud for that good one.
But this gives Sheamus an excuse to bitch if he actually uses it.
Or do what all hell say. You got lucky.
Or do what John Cena always does. You ain't a real man until you beat me twice. And then proceeds to sweep him.
Speaking of that, next fucking match. AJ Styles versus John Cena.
Great segue.
Oh, man, great match.
That match was phenomenal.
God.
It followed the John Cena formula, get your ass kicked for the first 17 minutes, then the last five you put up a fight. But then there was some extra.
But you know what? You know what made it different from that formula though? Everything Cena tried, AJ counted.
Yeah.
Cena just didn't do shit.
That five
unlike other Cena matches where Cena wasn't even trying. He was just beating the shit out of him.
Yeah, and then shoulder.
After that five knuckle shuffle, he counted into a head scissors from the ground. That was flat.
I like that because I thought he was just going to kick him in the face like Punk used to always do.
And
switch it up sometimes.
He did the calf crusher somewhere in the match. And John Cena actually sold it. He sold the leg after that. It's so much to the point where he couldn't bounce off when he actually did hit the five knuckle shuffle.
Yeah. He just dropped.
Yeah, he did an elbow drop. I mean, a fist drop. That's it.
Was there some damn kryptonite in the fucking arena? John Cena selling? Damn, what happened? Was the yellow sun not out?
Here's the thing. Here's what I thought it was.
Yeah.
What?
No, his last statement.
Oh. It was a lot of ring psychology going on. It was like John Cena. It was two different schools of wrestling. It was John Cena from the fucking WWE side. He's never been outside the WWE, except in the Indies, but that's not the point. Then you have AJ Styles, who's been all over the world. He has mastered all these fucking styles and shit. And John Cena has been trying to get some momentum going, but everything that he does, he gets countered. AJ has a counter for it. Except for that crazy-ass monkey.
That's my favorite part of that. When AJ out-wrestled AJ, got up, started running around the ring. I'm running circles around him.
Funny.
Man, you think he's Ali?
See, that's one thing that made me mad about Cena matches. Like, because it started at WrestleMania 23 when Shawn Michaels out-wrestled Cena, and Cena still won. This happens all the time. It's like, AJ Styles, John Cena talked all this shit about AJ Styles. AJ Styles told Cena that you can't beat me, I was going to run circles around you. That's what AJ did. How the fuck the match end up going the way it went to where AJ should have lost?
Because Cena got a little strong.
But that don't mean, but you got to do damage at some point. Is that AA that strong?
No.
Did they put that move on with that one?
I wish, now this is 2016 now.
This one is not involving Brock Lesnar.
This isn't the 2014 model.
Yeah. John Cena had
that one, sorry.
John Cena had put more points into that move again. Brock Lesnar already said his talents.
What other expletives did they blank out when AJ was talking about? That's all he got?
That's my favorite.
Shit.
That's
all
he got. Shit.
That shit was so funny.
Wait, they put that out live?
Yes. They put that shit live.
Oh, off gate for getting tape delay.
You know, thanks to Bret Hart, we got tape delay from now on.
Oh, yeah, well, he went off on Vince.
This is bullshit.
Thanks, Bret.
I don't know.
I think it's a 7 second take delay.
Yep.
I was gonna say, if you watch WCW and watch Scott Steiner, they took advantage of that 7 second delay. He got a mic, they bleeped out every other
WWE doing that, then Steiner can come back.
Oh no.
I'm looking for a hooch.
Boy, this man gonna be standing on that person's shoulder who's in charge of that sensor. Cause the moment he slipped one time.
I'm looking for a hoop.
Some other spots that happened, man. John Cena hit an AA on AJ. He kicked out at 2. AJ hit the Styles Clash. Cena kicked out at 2.
Well, who don't kick out
of the Styles Clash? That was another match. I think someone. No, okay. I'm thinking about another match. My bad. Right. Don't worry about that.
And then then the TNA moment happened where John Cena had him in the AA. And then next, you know, a ref bump, the referee gets kicked in the face. The team paying attention. Classic TNA. Unlike TNA, vintage TNA. Unlike TNA, it didn't completely ruin the match like it did that Samoa Joe versus Robert Roode match, but I'm not going to talk about it right now.
Oh,
okay.
Don't worry. Give it a couple of months. We'll see the rematch.
So there was about a 6 count, according to the crowd. The Gallows and Anderson ran down, beat the shit out of Cena for a couple of seconds, then they hit him with the Magic Killer. And ducked out like what?
Like a bunch of niggas, though. I mean, they pull up in that car slow. No, they actually ran out of the car.
Get the fuck out of here.
Hey, nigga. Let's smash the gas, man. Let's go.
I mean,
Gallagher
has to work on his speed, man.
Pull up.
Yeah,
Gallagher
got
it.
Pull up.
Rookie!
That hardcore West Coast gangster music. Hit that Magic Killer and get out of
here. It would be awesome if sudden hit the man field one and just screams, brace yourself, fool! What's their other tag move? The something boot? The
Buddha Doom!
Buddha Doom! Yeah, that's what, like, when he's about to bounce out the rope, he just screams, brace yourself, fool! Wham!
That'd be funny if they hit that shit, then they hit the magic killer, they ran out. I wanna die laughing, man.
You need to do that scene to make sure he don't kick out into it.
Yeah, right. Kick out of this shit.
That's evidence about what happened on Raw. Apparently, the magic killer is a move strong enough to put Cena down two nights in a row because that's what it had gotten for the three count.
But you know what happens with Cena? If it happened, it doesn't happen three times.
Even though it took the ref some time to get in, so Cena could have kicked out, he didn't kick out. So, yeah.
Maybe even kept
speaking of Cena on Raw, but they beat his ass quick when he hit that AA.
Oh, well, Anderson had to get squashed for it to happen, though. Anderson didn't get one off. He didn't even get a counter in. Like,
we learned already. You fuck over Cena.
Don't forget, he beat Jesus at Armageddon.
You fuck over Cena. That row after, he's going to destroy somebody.
That was the quickest fast forward I ever did. I was like, man, I already know if it happened. Cena finna beat the hell out of Anderson. Did that mean finna be no match? I start to fast forward. This shit was already happening. Like I said, Gallows, you need to. Shit, you always a step behind.
Shit, I was hey,
they hit that ring so quick, I'm like, what Gallows? His ass just not crawling.
This is how I remember how it happened. I fucking saw, like, the beginning, like, you know, AJ's like saying, you can take on any member of the club, wait for it, Cena, except me. And then when he saw you beat Carl, like,
I already beat you.
Because I already beat you. And then I'm like, I'm going to get me a glass of water. Next thing you know, I come back, and then, like, the beatdown's going down. I'm like, damn, that's... Yeah. He didn't even get a match.
Anderson got his ass kicked the whole little bit of time.
Wait, was this when? Was this like post Mania where he slayed the Wyatt family bath?
No, it was worse than that.
Okay.
No, it was worse than that. At least the Wyatt family had offense in. Anderson got his ass kicked.
Yeah, Cena was beating ass and the Wyatt just went off on him.
Okay, because I remember after he took the epic L from Lesnar, he had to rebuild himself and he pretty much slayed the Wyatt family single handedly.
Alright, now back to the pay per view. Okay. Next match was O'Neal versus Rusev. In a match that...
No, you're skipping the Money in the Bank, my friend.
That was after that, wasn't it? I forgot. I just wanted to get the Rusev match because it was so...
Well, we can review it right now. It sucked. Done.
Secret MVP...
Nah, I'll talk about it, but...
Secret MVP of that Money in the Bank match, Del Rio.
Yeah, I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah, I agree.
See,
I disagree. Oh, you said secret, never mind. The MVP was Sami Zayn.
That I can agree with.
And his monthly attempted murder on Kevin Owens.
That shit was just sick.
That knuckle driver?
Yeah, that was the whole shit moment of the
night. Yeah, that was just fucked up. Man, that was a murder.
Man, you two gonna kill each other before they even get all the...
Exactly.
Oh, man, he tried to kill him last night.
What happened?
He was about to powerbomb him off the state, off the ramp. Oh, Sami Zayn counted.
So he was about to kill him. He should have said, goodbye, Sammy, forever.
Goodbye, brother Sammy.
Man, that went to Sammy at the match. You powerbombed Sammy on the ladder, then crying on him and said, that's my country.
Oh, my God, man. Oh.
That part of the match where he was...
what's going on, man?
That part of the match where they had two ladders... in the rungs on each side.
Oh, that's
and all six of them were on the ladder. That was flat.
That's a good that picture. That's a good screenshot.
Goddamn Cesaro did. When that man jumped off the ladder.
And then
Springboard off the middle rope, then did the uppercut.
That's so some Swiss Superman shit right there.
I seen that shit that said, push that man nuts.
Cesaro was killing me in there, that man. Man, he had so many good spots. He had the fucking... The what do you call it? The uppercut train?
Yeah.
He was like, he's like, ooh! He kind of ran to each corner, man. He was fucking everybody.
And then Owens just said, okay, and then started cannonballing everybody.
Owens came in, threw him to the corner where the ladder was at, took out Cesaro, and then he said, shit, they sitting up.
And then Sami Zayn was trying to do the Haluva kick triangle. A couple of people ducked out, but he hit somebody.
He hit two people.
He hit fucking Jericho. Was it Jericho? And he split up.
Yeah, right. Two was in the corner.
And don't forget
caught both.
The swing.
Yeah, Jericho and Kevin Owens he caught. Yeah.
That was fucking.
And don't forget the swing when Cesaro did the swing. It just slung Jericho in the
That was fucked up, too. You remember the spot earlier in the match? I think Kevin Owens repeated the spot like in previous. I think Sami Zayn was pinned against the ring apron, and everybody thought he was about to cannonball or whatever, do something. He stopped and he super kicked the shit out of him.
That's the funny thing Kevin Owens did to me besides simple.
He looks like he's about to run and do like the most epic football kick or something, or punt, and he just like stopping and like
he sidestepped.
That shit is so funny. There were so many good spots in that match, man.
Yeah. Oh, I remember when we watched it at concert, it was like, Del Rio, no. Yes.
Del Rio.
Every time Del Rio doing anything, he's like,
I was having Sheamus flashbacks.
Hey, Del Rio already had enough good times. He got paid, so no. You don't need that title, too.
I was having Sheamus flashbacks. I was like, no, damn it.
He was going through PTSD.
I was like, somebody went and set Reigns, and then Sheamus was reaching. I remember last year... I remember, like it was yesterday, last year, I was like, somebody went and said Roman Reigns, then I saw Sheamus go, like, damn it, Roman, get it.
You cheer for Roman, and I was like, go, Sheamus, go.
I would cheer for Roman. Oh, well, Kofi, really, but at that time, I wanted Roman to win.
Speaking of Paro, wasn't that the night where they had that promo where Owens, Jericho, and Del Rio?
Yes.
And then he's like, what, are you going to call us Paro again? You know that means dog, right? He's like, you speak Spanish now? Well, that's all I ever call people.
He's like, no, I know that word because I thought he was a thing.
He was like, what, do you hate dogs? Do you all want something?
Yeah, what are you going to get dogs? And then Jericho just, you know, turned that around. Like, normally I hate the dumb puns and shit like that, but I'm like, all I see is like, Paro, idiot. Like, Jericho, so you can make funny. That shit work, but there's not too many other that superstars who could have so made that funny. Work.
Except for Becky Lynch. She
loves her puns. I was going to say, her puns.
She loves her puns.
I would love it if Kevin Owens somehow tied Paige in there when you talking about Paro.
Why don't you get your Paro and get out of here?
I can't recall the clusterfuck at the end. All I know is Dean Ambrose is the last one on that ladder. And he reached up and pulled down the briefcase.
He took a sweet time, too.
He grabbed Kevin Owens' shirt through the ladder and started smashing his head.
Oh, yeah. That's some cartoon shit. That's some Woody Woodpecker bullshit right there. Started pulling his shirt, and then he, like, oh, man. Interview he had. Yeah, was
Dean Ambrose won, but that shit was obvious to me.
Yeah.
Because going into the match, I'm like, Dean's winning this shit, and I said my dark horse was Jericho.
And then they gave it away at the beginning of the pay-per-view. Like, the opening promo to the pay-per-view, when they would say, who's going to lead Seth or Roman with the championship? Then they go. Then they cut into what Dean said at the end of Raw. Well, not the end of Raw, what he said on Raw.
That he's going to take the title
story. Yeah, they put that in the opening package. I was like, why would you even mention that?
If
Dean wasn't winning.
Foreshadowing.
No, because before the Roman Seth match, which, are we finna get into that now?
It's a filler match.
Rusev versus Titus on the
air. I already said
the best moment of the night.
Talk about it a little bit. Go ahead. Titus O'Neil failed in America again.
Thank you.
These Americans just keep taking these L's.
I already said he was going to lose. I mean, one, Titus is black, and two, he's American. Of course he was going to lose.
Yeah, that's how I found
out. American.
Thanks, Trump.
But then after the match, he said, you see your dad in there in the ring? He's a loser. Happy Father's Day.
That's on Crispin Wyatt.
Greatest heel moment of the entire month.
And that's about that's about the half of it. All right, now we can go to the main event.
Rusev won the month for me as a heel.
Yeah.
Bro,
you went up to his kids and just straight said,
your father's a loser.
Right in front of millions of fans here to see your dad be called a loser.
Happy Father's Day. Happy
Father's Day to the father of the year in WWE.
Irony.
I mean, he's not father of the decade. That's obviously Roman Reigns.
No, father of the decade is Vince.
Nah, it's Kofi Kingston. Y'all remember that?
No, father of... Oh, wait. This is 2016, right? Then, yeah, the father of the decade is...
Chris Benoit?
Yes. Next year, I can't say father of the decade.
He's still
he can't be father of the decade. He eliminated himself.
Seth versus Roman.
Great. Yeah, agreed.
I'm not going to say about Seth the Roman, but that promo I just mentioned, they used that same promo, but they didn't put the Dean Ambrose part in it. They cut it off right before they said that. But of course, I was into this match because I wanted to see Seth get his title back. And if you would have watched the 24/7 shit they had on the network, you would have also wanted Seth to get his title back.
Well,
so what? Just saying, if Seth's supposed to be a heel, why would you show us that? I mean, like, you feel nothing but sympathy for that man. That man was on top of the world, and he did one false landing to a move he used about 80 times a night. Fucked him up.
And, what else? Oh yeah, they fucked with the crowd again on the entrance. It said they made sure to only do the crowd and not the music this time because the music stayed the same while the crowd tailed off.
Oh, Roman gonna do?
Yes.
Damn, if they did fuck with the crowd then, but Roman got his shit moved out on him because yeah. I heard it. They were going the shit out of Roman. They must really fuck with it.
Yeah, they turned it down.
Well, as a pay-per-view crowd, what you expect?
Oh, shit. What were we talking about?
First of all, I love the damn match. I love Roman in this match more than anybody.
Yeah, another match of the year.
Because Roman, this is what you're supposed to do. Just talk shit to your opponents, man. Like, I said that when he fought AJ Styles. I was like, if Roman just get in there and make his opponent seem like they can't fuck with him, then he'll come off as a badass. Like, he go in the match, whatever you try to do, he stop and then just say, what the fuck that supposed to be? So shit like that.
Hey, you gotta be careful.
Just be more vocal, Roman.
You gotta be a little careful, guys. You cross the line, you go heel.
Well, yeah, but in this match, he played off heel. And then tripped me out when he was beating up Seth. He was like, what you thought this was?
Hey, we found Seth Rollins being a bitch the entire time.
He's like, you know what this was? You just a little brother. Then just go pushing their head into the mat. He
Roman's learning from the Mark Henry school of shit talking.
He made me root for Seth even more. Because I was like, man, fuck Roman right now. But, you know, I couldn't deny what Roman was saying because he was beating the shit out of him. Every time he did a move with Roman, he would just shake that shit off. Then he'll just toss his ass in the corner. The funniest spot in the match is when, I think, what's the name, slapped the shit out of him. So he just tossed him in the corner, propped him up on the top rope, then knocked the shit out of him.
What about that time where he completely no-sold the, the pedigree? No, it was the buckle bomb. He no-sold the buckle bomb, and then he turned around and Superman punched him.
The shit out of
him. God damn.
Hey, later on, though, when Roman Reigns started roaring, whipping a spear, Seth counted that to a pedigree.
Oh man!
The only part of the match I'm then like, you know why? Because that should have been the fucking finish. Because Roman kicked out and then Seth picked him up in pedigree and won. Why couldn't that third pedigree be the
finish?
Because
you had to bury him twice.
Yep.
Oh, okay. You can't bury Roman.
He buried himself.
He's Roman.
He buried himself. The Roman Empire has fallen.
You can say the first pedigree was the full thing because Seth Rollins really didn't hook him up all the way.
They even played into the fact that Rollins was a little tentative about his leg because that first Sunset Flip powerbomb he tried to do, he actually didn't do it, so he just rolled and turned into a buckle bomb. That was the one that Roman Reigns bounced into the Superman punch off of.
That was the second time.
Oh, it was.
The first time when he did it, the fight you were talking about, when he looked at his knee and looked at the crowd. Yeah. And then Roman reversed it. Then he kind of slid into it anyway.
Yeah.
Then he did a buckle bomb, and then he did that super kick on his knees that he always do.
Yeah.
The second time, he just picked his ass up and tossed him. And then right after that, he got punched in the face.
And the Spanish announce table didn't get his Hall of Fame moment Monday or Sunday.
Yeah, the barricade did.
Because every time Roman took it apart, it said, win in the ring. Is that thing stupid? He's always 2 steps ahead of Roman.
He forgot.
He knows going to happen. He'll get powerbomb through it.
We're glossing over one. We're glossing over one major part.
Yeah.
When Roman Reigns tried to take out Bacon on the outside with that wicked spear. See, this is where the roles switch because Seth Rollins was calling for his title. Like, give him my title or whatever. Yeah. Give him my title. Roman Reigns goes over there like, nah, this nigga ain't taking this title today. So he goes over there, winds up, tries a spear. Seth Rollins dives out of the way and fucking Roman Reigns eats the goddamn barricade. For like breakfast, lunch, and dinner. The blender.
Told you, Seth is always 2 steps ahead of Roman. That shit didn't look like nothing but a setup to me.
I remember earlier in the show, I said, depending on who won the match, Dean would cash in. Little did we know drugs would have something to do with that. But I said, if Seth won, Dean would cash in. I said, if they booked Roman to win, Dean's going to hold it.
No, Dean was cashing in anyway.
I didn't think he would cash in Roman.
I'm telling you, Dean was catching me.
I don't think he gave a fuck.
I know what he said, but that he was going to cash in on either one, but he would.
Yeah, I know, but I didn't expect if Roman won,
it's just the way shit going, like.
But that brand split, I expect him to cash in.
Exactly. That's what I took from it. I was like, first of all, Dean has to cash in and win the title, because I know some people said Dean's going to cash in, but he probably won't win.
Well,
if you want to do a triple threat match, Seth and Roman would need to have been tied to a ring.
But you never know. He could have cashed in at the night of the draft. You never know what could have happened. The GM of Raw or SmackDown could have put Seth in a match, and he would have got his ass beat.
Something weird happens. I'm trying to figure out how would he keep all three of them on the same show.
You can't.
Yeah, somebody's got to be on SmackDown.
One of them will get the plug. That's why I already knew what the main event for Battleground. Like I said, it was all predictable. The draft made all of it predictable to me. Cause like they want to get all their top feuds out of the way right now because of the draft.
At least
that's why we're gonna get Sammy and Kevin Owens for the last time.
Yeah, probably.
At Battleground
for now.
Oh no.
And I don't know what they're gonna do with the women's title, but
the rumor is gonna go between both shows.
I think, first of all, I think that's stupid, but that's just my opinion.
I mean, I guess the size of the women's roster right now.
Well, they good.
That's true.
I mean, you basically have to completely annihilate NXT.
If it was me, I wouldn't split the roster in the first place.
My thing is, why are they really going to have two pay-per-views a month?
Yes. That is craziness.
That would be dumb.
That'd be too much shit to watch.
Number one, their rosters aren't deep unless they are really going. They're really going to be reaching out to grab every motherfucker.
Yeah, but they're talking about signing 40-year-olds. I'm like, why are you signing more 40-year-olds for the brand? Shouldn't you be?
What are y'all going to try to make up for the lost generation that was the victim of Cena?
Well, here's the reason why they need people to go on TV right away. They don't want to bring in people from other places and bring them straight to TV. There's only a few people who can actually do that. So anybody they sign, they would have to go to NXT first. So what they want to do is bring people like Carlito and Shelton Benjamin back, people who've been on TV for years here, and they ain't got to tell them that. Just go out there and do shit.
I mean, even like, Angle got contact.
The thing about Angle, though. WWE signs Angle. I'd almost bet you money that he's going to be managing American Alpha because he is not going to fucking wrestle for WWE because they know that. He gets in the ring, Angle's going to do what Angle always does, and they're afraid he's going to miss out with himself.
The reason I was going to say about them bringing back these deep dough guys like that, because like, somebody like Adam Cole, I think Adam Cole should be in WWE. But to bring him in from Ring of Honor, you would have to teach him all that shit and then throw him on the main roster when they can just bring all them guys over who already know the shit. So that's why they're going after older guys. Like, okay, y'all can fill out our mid card. Bring y'all like. First of all, they already got people that can fill out the mid. Just give Jet Swagger a chance. I don't like him.
A lot of mid card guys who ain't doing nothing gonna have to do something.
You're gonna have to. That's what I'm saying.
Like, what is this the chance to finally make up for the lost generation that was the mid 2000s?
Nope.
And then think about it. Their brand split coming after you done pissed off guys like Rhodes, Ryback, Barrett, because those guys are needed now.
Ryback's
still in a contract.
Well, what's called the glass cannon?
Contract to go out. Then he's done.
Barrett,
like I said, Barrett's a glass cannon, so I mean, he got injured.
Cody, if he would have just sticked around about two more months, they could have gave him another real shot.
The question, would they? They probably would have kept him started.
True. But if he was on like SmackDown, then he would have actually gotten some real time.
But we need to get back to the pay-per-view real quick. Like, it's just short. Because we didn't even talk about the cash in. After the second shovel, Seth was celebrating for a little bit.
Dean comes out. Hey,
let me say something real quick. It's about the shovel. Because Seth Rollins, how long has Seth Rollins had this move now? It ain't that long.
8 months.
He already done saying that Triple H never done with this move. How you kind of spear into a pedigree?
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, he should have never tried at the Edge. Or
Goldberg. Or Batista. All these people use spear. Like, Triple H always played and said something gonna make that move crazy. He gonna pedigree somebody at the top rope one day. He might flip with it one time.
CM Punk's be like, oh, you son of a bitch.
He might do a springboard pedigree for all we know.
Hey, let's not go too far.
That's one of the moves of the year right there. That counted a spear into a pedigree.
I was mad when Roman kicked out, because when Roman kicked out, I'm thinking Roman finna win this match. Then when he just pedigrees him again, once he hit the second shovel, I was like, okay, Roman ain't kicking out of 2-1, and I was right. Then I was happy ahead of time and realized, damn, Dean got to come out here soon.
I like that Dean got
his title back.
Now, what I like,
what you want.
I was happy as hell until I realized Dean had to come out.
Yeah, then Dean's music played.
Then Dean did a bitch move.
Seth was
smooth. What are you talking about? That was a great move.
I don't get my cold. Yeah, my cold actually sold Dean Ambrose coming out pretty well.
Yeah, he did.
Came out from behind
and smashed his ass with that briefcase.
JBL was the funniest one. Oh, God, no.
Not this lunatic! This lunatic can't be our champion! Oh, man. JBL was funny.
They actually drunk that monster or something for that. They actually had
that Kickstarter. They had that Kickstarter, boy.
with the briefcase.
I will say this. I am glad Dean the champion, though, because I felt all three members had to be champion at one point.
Yes.
And Mike Chioda, being the smart ref he is, didn't screw around. He went on and cast that bitch in.
Chioda knew what was up.
Dean ran in, kicked him in the stomach, and hit the dirty D's.
You saw, I like the way he hit that dirty D's, because it looked like, so I was like, no! Because it was a high angle dirty D's. Usually it's a little lower. That shit was high as hell. I was like, oh! That shit was nasty.
Dean Ambrose gotta have a quick cash in, right? That shit went what, 4 seconds?
Dean's cash in was 9 seconds.
He felt like no 9 seconds. The bell rung after, you know, he locked him up and dropped it there.
Yeah. I mean, he just survived being in the room when being in the ring with the guy.
With the guy.
Kane's total time was 54 minutes with it. Dean Ambrose looked at 58 or 57.
and he won the title, and it reflected in the ratings the next night, because all of a sudden now people want to watch Raw on the third hour, in which the show still dies. The third hour is still dead.
The third hour is dead. But when you said
tell the main event,
you said you're gonna have Seth Rollins versus Roman Reigns, of course. I'll tell you, Seth Rollins and Dean Ambrose are the draw. Not Roman. And it's been proven. Because Roman's been there. And Dean been stuck in the mid-card and Seth's been hurt.
Well, it got proved last night.
Once they came back and they're featured prominently, look at the ratings.
You get Dean.
And what Vince going to say?
All they did, they gave Dean the title. And you can see it with the numbers. They jumped up. I like Roman's champion, though. It's just these IWC people.
But here's the real test. Will the ratings stay up next week?
Yeah, that's the thing. If they do, then maybe it was Roman. But until then, I'm not blaming Roman. I'm blaming the fans.
I'm blaming Roman.
I'm blaming the fans.
I'm blaming the fans. The fans don't want to see Roman. They want to see Dean. I'm blaming Roman.
Man, those fans full of shit.
Yeah,
If they don't want to watch Roman, they ain't got
to. He's the same fan.
So he's the blame.
He's the same fan that Vince listened to them. The title would chain hand 12 times before it all started.
I'm talking about that. They don't want to see Roman. They want to see Dean.
No, they want anybody who's not Roman.
Well, shit. They're putting it on somebody besides Roman.
It could be Heath Slater. They wouldn't care. The thing is, those fans are full of shit.
They can be full of shit. They want to watch who they want to watch. If they don't want to see Roman, don't use Roman.
If we go by that logic, a lot of smarts back in the Attitude Era didn't want Stone Cold Vince McMahon every week. But we got Stone Cold McMahon every week.
And the Raiders did not. First of all, the Raiders was hot.
His thing, the Raiders was hot. But his goal, his
people wanted to see all
his thing. The majority of the fans aren't internet smarts. People, that's the difference.
People wanted to see Austin.
Yeah, the thing is, X-Dog, smarts were a smaller percentage of the fan base in the Attitude
they
Era.
They still is now. They started a whole Council of WWE Network bullshit, and what happened? The network subscriptions went up. Damn, no, Council of the Network did the whole Give Divas a Chance thing. I said, please, they keep talking all this shit like they're that important. You don't mean shit.
First of all, the network number didn't go up. They wasn't counted for.
No, the numbers went up.
So when the numbers were counted for, yes, they went up.
But the thing is, they like
the number had been up. We just didn't know because there wasn't no.
But the thing is, they thought Council Network, oh, numbers gonna drop every time. Oh, I quit, like and the numbers went up.
And you know what? Because first of all, when the numbers came out right after that whole shit. So
no, I thought the numbers they counted the month after. They still kept going up, and they always kept going
you're
up.
Right. You're right about that.
They never went down.
You're right about that. The numbers went up. Of course the number was going to go up. WrestleMania was around the corner.
But then get everything for WWE went up. The only thing that was going down for WWE were ratings.
But
But their revenue, their income, everything were up.
Net revenue, Raven, not profits.
My point, this is
their
my
profits
point.
Were up.
This is why I blame Roman, because it's not Roman's fault of why the ratings are down, but the point is they don't want to see him. So it's his fault.
Well, at that point, you got to blame creative. It ain't Roman.
Well, I already blame creative. Yeah. I've been blaming creative for the past 2 years about Roman, and they listened for a month.
When they put Roman over Daniel Bryan, he became damaged goods at that point. So that was as simple as that.
That's creative.
Creative,
yeah. They ain't got nothing to credit that fact that
they don't want to see Roman.
Well,
because
they don't want to see Roman at the top of the card.
Hell, no, they ain't going to see him anymore for 34 days.
They only want to see Bryan at the top. Roman was seen as somebody taking Bryan's spot. Hell, he wanted Seth Rollins so bad. Hold on. He spent the whole year shitting on Seth Rollins, calling him the worst champion ever. He blows his ACL, and all of a sudden he loved this man.
Yeah, y'all, that's why I'm glad he laid into it in Baltimore.
Like I said, they are hypocritical as fuck. That's why WWE doesn't listen to him. Y'all love Seth Rollins, now they tore the ACL. That means just called Roman's champion now. When y'all spent the whole year shitting on this man, calling this man everything under the sun about him being paper champion, he's not worth anything, he's a shitty heel, he's the worst heel he ever had. All this stuff about Seth Rollins, as soon as he blows ACL, all of a sudden, man, we want him face because we love Seth Rollins, he's the man. Like, y'all didn't call him the man at all, y'all call him shit.
When the King of Burials himself, Triple H, beat the shit out of Roman Reigns, y'all cheered Triple H like he was the second coming or something like that.
That goes back to my point. They didn't want to see a heel Seth. They wanted a face. They wanted Dean Ambrose. Even me, and I hate Dean right now. Why? Because he took the title for Seth. But then what I'm saying, when Seth came back, they wanted Seth's face. That's why they cheered him, because they think they control the WWE. That's why they shitted on Seth coming back as heel.
Well,
Well, I no, duh, you don't control
even
him.
After all that. Exactly. His title reign did kind of suck.
Yeah, I said his title reign sucked.
His title reign did not suck to me.
He did
what he was supposed to do as a heel.
As far as title defenses and that's what I mean by it sucked. Not everything. As far as the matches went, the title matches, that's why I say it sucked. They made him look like,
Seth said in their magazine talking how much the fans hate him in the ring, and Seth said, good, they're supposed to, I'm being a heel. He said, I already know that some fans, he got to act the way he acts just to get them to boo him.
I didn't hate him at all. No, but I just hated the way they booed him.
I thought when he talked in that interview, he said exactly what I said. He had to act a certain way to make sure, he said, a certain group of fans will also hate him as well. And I said, he already knew that other group of fans are going to say, up here cheer for him no matter what he does. Because they just love Seth Rollins, but he acts the way he acts, and him act like as a piece of shit champion, as a heel, running away acting like a coward, they going to hate that on Seth Rollins.
He's supposed to do that.
They wanted him to be a Triple H type heel where he's a badass heel, and now a cowardly heel the way he was acting. Man. When you up here cheer, when you celebrate the fact that you lost the match and retained your title... Lillian Garcia do that?
That's not even what I'm talking about, though. That's what they want and what he did and what he was supposed to do. That don't mean his title reign was good.
His title reign was good.
It's how the people interfere. It ain't got nothing to do with Seth. It's the people around him what made his reign.
Local man.
The promo, all that shit. Like,
it was not Seth. It was everybody else. The circle.
That was the whole thing about Seth. Had the authority and everybody at his side. Everybody up here just completely fuck up anything in that title run. Basically make him seem like he's that great of a champion. And Seth believed he was that great of a champion despite J&J, despite his Triple H and Stephanie's in doing everything in their power to protect him.
First of all, Seth was a great champion. The title reign still sucked.
But the thing is, he up here, his thing about title reign, he held that title so long because he had all these people backing him up, and it went to his head, him thinking he's that great of a champion to the point. To the point this man started disrespecting Triple H right in front of his wife.
Well, he should have, because he was the man. But Triple H was no longer the man.
But the man.
The Shield is the man, the guy, and the dude.
But the thing is,
dude,
the man up here sacrificed everybody up here to keep the championship. He sacrificed Kane, he sacrificed J&J. He transformed into the Undertaker to take out Brock Lesnar.
Seth said it at the get-go that he wanted to be the greatest of all time. He didn't care who he had to sacrifice. He was willing to sacrifice Triple H to Stephanie as long as he was the champion and was the man. Think about it. Dean and Roman had his back through his entire run. And what he did? Beat the shit out of both of them.
God damn, niggas sound like Kaiba.
I mean, don't
sacrifice
like,
everything for the Blue Eyes White Dragon.
Like I always say, it don't matter how you get the win, as long as you get the win. No, and Seth won time after time after time. The problem I did have was Seth was losing too much on TV.
Remember the fit with Kerry? That man was in over his head.
I hear what you're saying, though, but he's still a WWE champion.
But he's in over his head. I know. He thinks he's greater than what he actually is, but everybody had his back and keeping that belt on him.
I know what you're both saying, but I got to end this episode. God damn it.
Y'all are cutting the circles now.
No, it ain't circles. It ain't NASCAR just yet, but chicken.
Turn
and,
left.
And okay, I will turn left. Wait, that's pit road. Never mind. There's the corner. Okay. That was the end of Real Wrestling episode 46. Hopefully you enjoyed it. We should have a wrestling draft coming up soon. So yeah. And that event. Everybody say peace.
Peace.
Fuck boys.
What?
Nice.
Nice.